So we are now recording. Great. I see the attendees swarming in, which is wonderful. Hi, everybody. I'm Dr. Angela Rogers, and I have my host and amazing colleague on the line as well. You want to introduce yourself?
Hi, everybody. It's me, Dr. Renee Thomason. I'm excited to be on this call tonight with you guys. Just briefly, I am a board certified family medicine physician. Met Angela at one of the NAF conferences, and we started this Let's Talk webinar back in September. I have a strong passion for advocating for the alopecia community. So I'm excited because we've been learning through these webinars. You can check out our past webinars on our YouTube video through NAF. I will share that link today. In the chat, but I will pass everything over to Angela right now. But I'm excited. Please let us know in the chat where you guys are coming from.
Awesome. So yes, also family medicine, board certified physician for myself, and I currently work full time in the emergency department in Northern California, and I absolutely love it. Also love advocacy in the alopecia community, which is why Dr. Renee and I went ahead and started this webinar series. And I want to go over a few Zoom rules before I introduce our amazing guest speaker, Dr. Aimee Rowe. So a couple of rules for Zoom. So I would like everyone to mute themselves. And when the time comes for Q&A after the presentation, we'll go ahead and allow everyone to unmute themselves. Yes, please go ahead and write down your name and where you're calling in the chat. We'd love to see who is here. This Zoom will be recorded and it will be posted on the NAF YouTube webpage, as well as the NAF Let's Talk webpage. And this is the Let's Talk webinar series. So I am gonna go ahead and introduce our guest speaker briefly, but I'm going to have her introduce herself a little bit more. So today's episode is very special. There's so many questions that we get about individuals, not only relating to alopecia, but also other autoimmune conditions, as autoimmune conditions kind of roll in packs, as some of us know. And so today's episode is entitled Alopecia and Beyond, Staying Healthy, Living with Autoimmune Conditions. And today we have Dr. Aimee Rowe, which I'm very excited to introduce. So a little bit about her before she goes into herself a bit more. So she went to UC Davis School of Medicine here in Northern California in Sacramento, and that is where I met her. We are colleagues who were in the same class. And so it was a pleasure to meet her and to get to know her. And now we're really good friends. From UC Davis, she went on to family medicine residency at Oregon Health and Science University. And it was a really incredible rural family medicine program. And then from there, she is now currently the UCSF Integrative Medicine Fellow Family Medicine Physician, which has been a really great experience, it sounds like. But I'm going to let her go into a little bit more about herself and specifically what integrative medicine is and how she got involved in that field and how it relates to autoimmune conditions. So go ahead and take it away, Dr. Rowe.
Thank you, Angela. Thank you, Renee, for having me. Thank you for that lovely introduction. You know, I think maybe I will kind of do like the first couple slides are about integrative medicine. So maybe I will explain what it is and then sort of talk about how I got interested in it, if that works. Okay, so let me go ahead and share my screen. Okay, and it's good. You can see the, okay, awesome. All right. Okay, so we're talking about alopecia and beyond, staying healthy with a variety of different autoimmune conditions. And kind of, I thought it'd be helpful to have a general, I wanted to say roadmap, but I was like, I don't like roads. We don't need any more roads in our lives. We're gonna be on like a meandering river and enjoying the countryside. So we'll talk about what is integrative medicine and also kind of just give a framework for how I'm thinking about what I'm presenting to you. Well, then we'll kind of go on like the main things, which is nutrition, physical activity, mind-body practices, aka like stress resilience and sleep, and then have our question and answer period. These are the things I go through with really, I mean, I try and do it with all my primary care patients, but time is limited in primary care, but definitely with my integrative medicine patients where I have a little bit more time, I always try and do talk about all of these things with them. So this is my disclosure slide, which is basically, I just want to acknowledge kind of two main things. One is that obviously I'm not a dermatologist, I'm not a rheumatologist, I'm not a researcher, but I do see a lot of patients with a lot of chronic conditions, including autoimmune conditions. And I do find these things help them. And also I've mentioned like specific like apps and companies and resources. I am not financially invested in any of these. I just want you all to like know about them and have access to them. So what is integrative medicine? Angela and I didn't even discuss this. I just thought that this would be something that people would want to know. Also, as patients that are going through kind of the experience of having a chronic disease, you're probably going to come across a lot of these different terms. And I just kind of wanted to explain what all of that is. So there's many different definitions. The University of Arizona is one of the first centers for integrative medicine, and I do like their definition. It's pretty straightforward. It's a healing-oriented medicine. It takes into account the whole person. It emphasizes lifestyle. It emphasizes the therapeutic relationship between practitioner and patient. It's still informed by evidence, and it makes use of all appropriate therapies. And I think the real key there, well, there are many keys, they're all highlighted, but certainly the all appropriate therapies is a big part of it. So typically, when you see someone who's an MD or also a doctor of osteopathy, a DO, they're mainly practicing what like you might hear called like conventional, allopathic, or biomedicine. So that's like, we'll use a lot of medications. There's like procedures, there'll be injections, we'll remove things. There are surgeries. There's also things like prevention and screening, particularly in primary care. And then when you hear words like complementary and alternative medicine, you might also hear it called like natural medicine. And there are like probably dozens of things that fall under that category, but you might hear words like functional medicine, naturopathic medicine, chiropractic, osteopathic manual manipulation. This is also like where we think about acupuncture. And I know you already heard from an Ayurvedic physician, energy medicine, Rolfing, homeopathy, biofeedback, all of those things, particularly for research purposes, are considered complementary on an alternative medicine. And you might also come across, so technically complementary would be it's in addition to what we're doing in biomedicine. Alternative is something that would be completely separate from it and you're not using biomedicine at all. But those have kind of lost their meaning a little bit. So integrative medicine, I would say, kind of falls in this magical area right between where they overlap in the Venn diagram. So really we are thinking, when someone is an integrative medicine doctor, they're primarily trained in medical school as a biomedical doctor, but then they also are thinking about how are all these other things gonna benefit them. And truly there's like a lot more overlap than it would be wrong to just say, oh, I do that as an integrative medicine doctor and no one else does. Of course, many of my friends that are just MDs that don't call themselves an integrative medicine doctor talk to their patients about lifestyle and diet and exercise and meditation and might say, hey, go try acupuncture. But I just have a little bit more background and training in it. And then conversely, doctors that are naturopathic doctors or even that practice acupuncture, they're also going to be thinking about biomedical issues and might send a patient to a physician if they're worried about something. So there's really a lot of overlap in these two, but integrative medicine is kind of one of the words that we've used to kind of capture that. So thinking about all of this, I try and operate on the phrase that you'll hear a lot of integrative medicine doctors say, which is keep your mind open, but not so open it falls out. And we're really referring to evidence. In biomedicine, we talk a lot about evidence-based medicine. And that's important. We want to know that the things we're suggesting for patients are actually going to be useful, that they're not going to be harmful, that it's essentially not a waste of time and money and resources and exposing people to potential risks. At the same time, some things are harder to study than others. And then also funding is a huge issue. Also, the kind of culture of research can be difficult sometimes, just in the sense that in biomedicine, we really want to get down to like the individual parts, but a lot of things really work synergistically, and it's much harder to kind of find evidence for those things. So all that being said, today, I think we're going to talk about things where there's more and less evidence for things. I really wanted you all to get an appreciation for areas where there is some evidence, because I think there is value in you understanding why I'm recommending these things, besides me just feeling like whimsical and liking something, like, why do I recommend these things? But aside from that, it's just tough to find evidence for alopecia and also other autoimmune lifestyle changes or things that we'll look at. I did a PubMed search for integrative medicine and alopecia areata, and like 6 studies came up. Like, there's just not much out there. And even for autoimmune, there's some stuff, but you could certainly say that there needs to be a lot more research. That being said, there's definitely studies in here that we will talk about. And why I feel comfortable talking about this anyways is that I think everything we discussed today is going to enhance the quality of your life. An analogy that we talk about, which is why I have this picture, is tending to your soil. So what we're going to be doing is creating healthy soil for you. And from that soil, you can have a beautiful tree. So we'll basically be working on kind of helping your garden thrive. The nice thing and the reassuring thing to me was when I listened to the presentation to prepare for this on the traditional and Ayurvedic approaches to alopecia, I feel like both Dr. Shirsagar and Dr. Maisnikovaka, sorry if I said that wrong, might have mentioned some of these things. So I think that we are all on board that these things can be helpful for you. All right. So let's talk about nutrition. Woo! There it is, the standard American diet, abbreviated SAD, not coincidentally. It's not good for us. We know it. This is a study actually from Spain. They followed 20,000 university graduates over 14 years. And they looked at people that were consuming ultra processed food, which they considered things basically that are ready to eat and drink. So carbonated drinks, sausages, cookies, donuts, fruit yogurts, instant soup, noodles, sugared milk and fruit drinks, and divided them into essentially a first and second quartile that were eating a lot of them. And then the third and fourth quarters were not eating as much. And as you can see, the yellow dashed line are those that are in the highest 2 quartiles of eating this ultra processed food had much higher rates of all cause mortality. So there's many studies like this. There's no question that this is not a healthy way to eat. So thinking about diet and inflammation. So the effects of diet on inflammation, it's kind of hard to show, but essentially this study was looking at it was a review paper looking at different types of diets, and they concluded that a whole diet approach, which we mean whole fruits and vegetables, legumes, whole grains, poultry and fish, can help. And it can help probably reduce inflammation associated with metabolic syndrome, and it can bring down many issues with chronic disease. I really like this last sentence. Essentially, Western dietary patterns warm up inflammation while prudent dietary patterns cool it down. And specifically the Western dietary patterns, they're referring to the standard American diet. This little diagram is just their fancy way of showing that healthy diets decrease these markers of inflammation and therefore decrease the pro-inflammatory bilirubin is what they call it. So what is our alternative? You've probably heard of some of these. There's the DASH diet. There's the Mediterranean diet. There's the anti-inflammatory diet. These are all slightly different, but they essentially have some overlapping themes that I want to go over with you all. I prefer the phrase plant-forward diet because I think it really captures the essence of what we're trying to do. Or plant-based might be another phrase. I also kind of like it because I think it avoids sort of, I heard a researcher once say there is no diet as fetishized as the Mediterranean diet. So I think, which is like one of our most studied diets. So I really like the idea of not putting emphasis on a particular culture's wisdom, because I think all cultures have inherent wisdom in them. But what we're really trying to do is bring plants to the forefront. So the definition of plant-forward diet is a style of cooking that emphasizes and celebrates plant-based food. It's fruits and vegetables, whole grains, beans, legumes, and soy foods, nuts and seeds, plant oils, and herbs and spices. So specifically, let's kind of break those down. Vegetables and fruits have high concentrations of polyphenols, which are antioxidants, carotenoids, which are antioxidants, and then high fiber, which is important for a reason we will get to. So you want to eat lots of vegetables and pull from the entire color spectrum, just as we have in this picture. The whole grains, we want to focus on grains that are we call whole grains. Specifically, you might have heard the phrase low glycemic index, which means that our body absorbs it slowly. It gives steady energy, it doesn't spike our blood sugar. And what we're really going for are grains that are intact and have large pieces. So that's like the ones that are pictured here: brown rice, basmati rice, wild rice, barley, quinoa, steel-cut oats. I love oats for my patients because they're pretty easy to make and they're very healthy. And really note that we're talking about the grains themselves and not their flour products. So of course, for the most part, whole grain bread is better than white bread. But really, and you can have some of that, but really you want to be focusing on actually eating the physical grains. Then we have our beans. So lots of different kinds of fun beans to explore. I think there's a greater variety than a lot of us know in a traditional American eating. So like garbanzo, the pintos, the black beans, the kidney, the navy, all of these different kinds. And then we also want to think about omega-3s. So we have this, there are many different kinds of fatty acids. Most of us in America are getting more of the omega-6s than the omega-3s. And we want to change that balance a little bit because omega-3s tend to be anti-inflammatory. So places we can get those are algal oil. We can get flax seeds. Really, they have to be ground or milled. Chia seeds, which are these guys. Walnuts are a great source. Soy foods are a great source. Pumpkin seeds are a great source, and hemp seeds are a great source. These guys, you can just throw in that easy to make oatmeal, no problem. And then there are also fish that are high in omega-3s. So salmon, mackerel, herring, lake trout, sardines, and albacore tuna. Conveniently, most of the fish that are high in omega-3s tend to be lower in mercury. You still kind of have to watch out for it. The king mackerel tends to be high, so that's why I tell people to stay away. A lot of these are nice. They could just come in little cans. You can get the lake trout in cans. You can get the sardines and tuna in cans. You just kind of mash it up and throw it in a salad for lunch. Okay, and then there are the spices. These are pictures of our ginger, our turmeric, and our cloves. I just wanted to highlight this study because they actually show that these spices have some anti-inflammatory properties. So this was a study, they took 10 to 12 subjects, they ate an herb or a spice for 7 days, and they ate them, importantly, at the levels we would normally eat them in our diet. Excuse me, so like a half a teaspoon a day, something like that. Then they took some human cells in a petri dish that had been exposed to an inflammatory insult, and then essentially dropped the blood onto those cells and saw how much of an inflammatory response there was. So for this one, they measured a marker of inflammation called tumor necrosis factor, or TNF-alpha. And they showed that for clove, ginger, the rosemary, and turmeric, there was actually a blunted response in the inflammation, which is what we would want over time. Okay, let's talk about the microbiome. I'm going to pause for some water. So obviously the microbiome is super hip right now for good reason. It's really an interesting time to be working in this because I think we're like really sort of like at the leading edge of this. Like we still have so much to learn about how this affects us. And also how do we help patients who we suspect or know have a microbiome that isn't as robust as we'd like. And I should say that I am referring, of course, to the microbiome in our GI tract. I'm sure you've heard things like we have more cells of other microbes in our body than we have cells in our own human makeup. And also very important for us and what we're talking about with autoimmune diseases, because over 70% of the immune system is actually housed in the gut. And so we know that we are very connected to our microbiome. Essentially, one of the phrases that I say is that like our microbiome is tutoring our immune system because there is such a close interaction. Additionally, we use our microbiome's metabolites for repairing and healing our own cells in our GI tract and beyond. So they're very important. So what I wanted to highlight here is a couple of things. So this is taken from a lecture I actually saw recently from a husband and wife team. They have a lab at Stanford called the Sonnenberg Lab. I don't think this is published yet, but this is a shot from one of their PowerPoints. They essentially were looking at people, they had people eat fermented food over 3 months and then checked markers of inflammation. And you can see kind of just very straightforwardly across the board, the fermented foods decreased inflammation. So other takeaways from their research were that eating fermented foods increased microbiome diversity and decreased inflammation. We can see that happening here on this slide. Interestingly, probiotics did not increase microbiome diversity and did not affect inflammatory cytokine levels. So probiotics, I mean just like the pills that we take. Also importantly, the participants who had the best response also had a high fiber diet. And so of course, fiber is what we get from our fruits and vegetables and also from our whole grains. So that is another compelling reason to get a lot of fiber in your diet. You're basically giving our like little friends in our gut the food that they need to do their metabolic processes to produce the metabolites that we as our body also uses. So if you're curious to learn more, I know the Sonnenbergs just wrote a book all about this. And you can check it out. So I would also encourage you, and I really encourage all my patients to get fermented food into their diet. It sounded like from their research, they really found like 2 to 3 servings a day is what kind of helped participants get to that increased level of diversity. And they can be tiny servings. So like a quarter cup of sauerkraut or like a little bit of kombucha. So this is a list of fermented foods, including the kombucha, pickles, if they're naturally fermented, sauerkraut, kimchi, yogurt, if it's a live culture. Please do not eat one of the yogurts that has a bunch of added sugar in it. Kefir, miso, and tempeh are all great for this. And I should say, I'm imagining a lot of these slides, I put a lot of words on them. And my thought is that if you, once this is up, you can come back to it and like pause and like write down the resource. So hopefully that will work for us. All right, so I feel like I just threw a lot of information at you. How do you process this? How do you use it something useful and not let it stress you out? I'm going to borrow from the food writer, Michael Pollan, one of my food heroes from his book, In Defense of Food. Just eat food. Would your great-great-grandmother recognize it? If that person wouldn't recognize it, it's not food. Eat real food and not a food-like substance. Not too much. So just enough to make you feel full. And mostly plants, really focus on the plant. Again, that plant-based diet. And I find myself thinking about that a lot as I sort of do my own meal planning. And just to circle back, I want to emphasize what is not included in this, which are things like in the plant-based diet, which are things like red meat, pork. There's not a lot of processed meat. There's not a lot of trans or partially hydrogenated fat, which are the things that are kind of in like the pre-made like cookies and other sweets that you can buy. And then there's minimal saturated fat. So that's like our dairy. Another kind of easy way to visualize it, I really like the Harvard School of Public Health healthy eating plate. So essentially looking at it, half the plate is vegetables and fruits, a quarter of it is a whole grain, and then a quarter of it is a healthy protein. And they also remind us to drink water as well. And I am kind of curious, like, will fermented foods be added to this at some point? I wonder, you know, these guidelines are based off the USDA guidelines, which are like a big to-do when they sort of debate how they should be changed every couple of years. And I do wonder as time goes on if like fermented foods will be added on. So a couple of ideas also as to how to do this. One is to join a CSA, which is a community supported agriculture. So you're getting fresh food that's made or produced, grown locally. And you can kind of, based on what you want, you can do it weekly, every other week, monthly, there's lots of options. Some people don't like this because you don't always have control over which produce you're getting, but I actually really like it because it's just, it arrives and then I have to eat it or I'll feel guilty if I don't eat it. And if there's something weird in there that I don't know what it is these days, I just Google it on the internet and find a recipe and get to experiment. Another idea that I sometimes encourage my patients to think about are these meal delivery services. And the reason I like these is for people who like really need a really easy place to start. These are really, it's a very easy activation level. So there's complete meal delivery services. And I honestly, some of these, I'm in the Bay Area, and so these are tailored to the Bay Area. I know some of these are nationwide. Some of them might be just kind of in this area, so forgive me. So they're complete meal delivery services where like, I think you just get it and maybe heat it up and you can eat it. And then there's also ones where that I'm sure you've heard about where they send the ingredients and you make it in 30 minutes or less. So lots of ideas there. I also remind folks, you don't have to, obviously this is not for every meal of every day of the week. It's like, you can get like 3 meals a week and it can kind of be like a place to start. Oops. Okay. And then kind of like I suggested, I will sometimes just do internet searches if I have, it's nice to have it these days, because if I have random ingredients and you don't know what to do, you can just like do a recipe. I also did, I did a search for plant-based meals under 30 minutes and I think I got like 500 million hits. So lots of ideas out there. And then again, like you could also take a class. Like these are skills that we used to learn from our family and our culture. And now it's, sometimes we still do, but it's not as common as we used to. So it might be fun to take a class just to get new skills, like learn from, maybe you know how to do some cooking techniques, but not others. So that's another fun way to go. Particularly once the pandemic has resolved and we can meet again in person. All right, let's move on to physical activity. So basically, we know that physical activity is important and essential. There are many, many health benefits. The ones that I wanted to highlight for us is that it lowers all-cause mortality, it improves quality of life, it reduces anxiety and depression, it improves sleep. And then in general, for people with chronic medical conditions, it again decreases all-cause mortality and improves physical functioning and quality of life. And then, of course, we also know that the risk of dying prematurely declines as people become physically active. So look at that nice little curve. This is minutes of vigorous or moderate physical activity, and this is relative risk, and it just gets better and better the more active you are. And I do want to acknowledge that probably at some point this becomes a U-shaped curve is what we call it in medicine. When the relative risk for mortality starts going up, these are like our like insane super athletes. There is, you know, there's still lots of controversy and debate around that. It's probably the case. I don't think that's probably an issue for most of us, for the vast majority of us. So how much exercise do we need? This is actually from the CDC. I included both the children and the adolescents because I figure there are probably some parents on here, and then also our adults. So kids need about 60 minutes a day. They can do lots of things. And then at least 3 of the days of the week, it should be like vigorous activity. Adults, which are aged 18 to 64, need at least 150 minutes a week of moderate activity. And then 2 days a week, we should do strength training. So essentially, to break that down for adults, it's more or less 30 minutes a day, 5 days a week of moderate activity. So what is moderate? That means that you can talk, but you cannot sing. And then vigorous activity, you can break that down, and it's only 75 minutes of vigorous activity a week. And that you will not be able to say a few words without pausing for a breath. And again, these are, I want to acknowledge that these, so there's several organizations that make these activity guidelines, but this is from the CDC, but essentially all of them are some version of this. You want to be active, you want to have some strength training, and you want to do some stretching. And let's see. Yeah. And I think I essentially, like, it's very hard to prove that physical activity can affect autoimmune disease and inflammation. But I think we know that there are many reasons to be doing this for all of us. All right. And I wanted to make a note, specifically another thing that is very hip right now, besides the microbiome, is worrying about our sedentary time, which has always been a risk. And then in the pandemic, when so many of us are working from home and just knowing not going out as much, is even more of a risk. So this was a kind of what we call a review and meta-analysis that gets published. So that's when researchers look at many, many studies and then try and compile them and see if there is a trend. So this looked at 47 articles. It was mainly patients or study participants that were self-reporting their exercise levels. They looked at cardiovascular disease. They looked at diabetes and all-cause mortality. And they found that prolonged sedentary time was independently associated with deleterious, so bad health outcomes, regardless of physical activity. So no matter how physically active someone was in terms of the kind of exercise they would do, if they had prolonged sedentary time, they had an increased risk of bad health outcomes. So that means it's time for 2020. Okay, I'm going to ask everyone to stand up. And this is coming out of research that shows that, I don't know if it's research, it's what eye doctors recommend. Every 20 minutes, we should take a look at something, take our eyes off the screen, look at something 20 feet away, and do that for 20 seconds. So I'm going to suggest we should all do that right now. I'm also going to have us stretch a little bit. So stand up if you want to. I can't stay too far away, but let's stand up, bend your knees and kind of like bounce, wiggle your arms around. Thanks, Angela. You can look like a Muppet. All right, let's stop. Let's kind of like stretch over to the right here. We can do the same thing, stretch over to the left. I'm looking at the screen, but you don't have to. Turn your head to your right shoulder. Turn your head to your left. Look up, look down. Oh, do the shoulder rolls. Oh yeah, I do this when I'm sitting at the computer. Reverse the direction to get my shoulders to relax. Really important for sitting all day, we got to stretch our hamstrings. So you can put your left foot out, kind of just like bend over and get that hamstring stretch a little bit. And then pull that left leg back and then put your right leg out and get that stretch a little bit. Okay, good. All right, we're all gonna live. But I do encourage my patients, and I would encourage you to set an alarm on your phone. If you're sitting for a prolonged period, just every 55 minutes or so, set that alarm and like walk around for like 2 minutes. All right, so carrying on. This was a study. So as I mentioned, I wanted to try and find if I could find studies that kind of talked about our topic specifically related to alopecia areata. There weren't many, but there was one study that was looking at the relationship between physical activity level and symptoms of depression, anxiety, and stress in individuals with alopecia. this was kind of a small study. It was 83 respondents. They self-reported with a questionnaire. But they did find that findings suggested that increased physical activity participation in alopecia areata individuals who had severe hair loss, which they defined as more than 50%, it was associated with improved mental health status. That really should not come as a surprise to any of us, but it is reassuring to see it in the literature. All right. I did want to mention something else here, which was interesting, and also to support and encourage activity, which is that there was a paper that came out in 2017 from the American College, or excuse me, actually critiquing or questioning the American College of Physicians guideline for depression treatment and asking why they didn't talk about exercise more. And this paper essentially did its own meta-analysis, so looking at all the studies, which they said that the American College of Physicians didn't do, and said that pretty much all of these reviews supported the use of exercise. It might not have been as good as our depression medications, but it certainly was an excellent adjuvant, so something that should be added on whenever we're thinking about depression. So there really is a pretty clear and consistent signal in the literature that physical activity is good for mood issues. All right, but let's think about it. Exercise is always hard for people. We always have excuses. So I wanted to kind of talk about some ideas for how to bring this into your daily life. So different ideas. One is to start slow, and you can tie it to a habit that you already have. Kind of researchers that do work on how do we create good new habits, they say tie it to something you already do, like brushing your teeth, something you know you already do every day. And then make it small at first. So just be like, well, after I brush my teeth, I'm just gonna do 5 sit-ups, like something like that. You can have a walking routine during the workday. That's another good way to get away from the screen for a little bit. Some people end up exercising on the weekends. I like this idea of increasing workout intensity, which is very, very American in maximizing efficiency. So instead of doing the 150 of moderate, you do the 75 minutes of intense exercise. Obviously, finding a workout partner is a great idea, someone else that wants to be active. It's great to have a buddy. We know that helps. You can also, of course, now it's very, very common. It was not so common before to be exercising at home. I'm sure you have found that there are many DVDs and internet-based fitness programs at this point. Obviously, you could go to a gym, much like cooking and the other things that we'll talk about. Sometimes it's good to like work with a professional to kind of help you figure out a good program and routine. Some people are very motivated by the measurement tools in terms of like, what's my heart rate? How many steps am I getting? I think it really works for some of my patients, not for everyone. Kind of related to this, you could look into what kind of tendency you are. And this comes out of work from Gretchen Rubin. I don't think this is evidence-based, but I think it is fun. She has a book called The 4 Tendencies, and you can go to her website and do like a little 8-question quiz and find out what she means by tendency is what are your internal and external motivators. And then based on that, and there's like the rebel, the questioner, the upholder, the obliger. And so based on which one you are, she has suggestions on habit change techniques that work for you. So someone who really needs external validation might want the measurement tool, whereas someone who's more of an obliger might find that having an exercise partner is more helpful for them. And finally, do something that you enjoy. You're not gonna do it if it's not fun. So find something that's actually fun that you enjoy, whatever that is for you. And then I did just wanna take a pause here and recognize, obviously we have to think about safety with movement. There are risks with exercise, like anything. It's so funny how this is so caveated into the medical culture, but I mean, there's risk with eating too. You could choke while you're eating, but you could get injured. You could have, there's exercise-induced asthma. You could get too hot or too cold. Female athletes can get the exercise triad and have their menstrual cycles altered. So if you're worried at all, please go talk to your doctor. You can ask about medical clearance. Most people don't need medical clearance before they start exercising, especially if you are already a little bit active. But obviously, if you have trouble breathing at rest, if you have chest pain, if sometimes you feel your heart beating, or if suddenly you decide you want to train for an Ironman and you have not really exercised before, these are good times to go and talk to your primary care doctor. So please do that. All right, let's talk about mind-body practices and stress resilience. The longer I do this, the more I don't want to say I don't like the term mind-body, but I feel like it is, it's not accurate or it's lacking in something, in the sense that I think the mind-body connection is so nuanced and so closely tied together that even saying mind-body suggests that they're two different things, right? But I think they're so intrinsically tied together. So when I talk about this, it's not something where I'm saying, oh, this is something that's in your head that will make you feel better. Like it is one system that works together. All right, so what are we doing here? Again, very, very small data in terms of like how these specifically affect alopecia areata and autoimmune diseases. But what we're really trying to do is work on stress and relaxation and stress resiliency that we know everyone needs. So this is from kind of like a theory paper that was published in 2009 by Dr. Dusick and then Dr. Benson, who kind of was, I would say, like the biomedical pioneer of relaxation under the relaxation response understanding and trying to figure out why this stuff is important for us. So on the, let's see, what side of the screen? I think that would still be the left side of the screen for you, the white part that says stress response. It's kind of showing what's happening in our body when we get a stress response. And this is the classic like, oh, I am a caveman outside and a saber-toothed tiger is trying to attack me and I'm running away. These are all the things that are happening in our body to help us survive. So as I'm sure you have heard, this is great short term, we need this. When this is going on chronically, this is when we start to get concerned about the stress response. And so what Dr. Benson and Dr. Dusick were really arguing for was we also need to understand the relaxation response, which is essentially all of this stuff happening in the opposite direction. So what are the things we can do to get our body to naturally activate the relaxation response? You might also have heard about this as our parasympathetic nervous system, which is our calming, rest and digest, versus our stress response would be our sympathetic, which would be like our fight or our flight. And we know these things are important. I helped revise a chapter on multiple sclerosis. So some of the data I also have from there, which is that we know, for example, that with multiple sclerosis, psychological stress is definitely a trigger for relapse and possibly contributes to disease progression. So we know we haven't quite figured out the nuances, but there's certainly some evidence that these things do matter and are important. And kind of like I just mentioned, it's really hard to find data showing exactly how mind-body practices affect the inflammatory pathway. This is kind of a crazy study, but I love it so much. I just had to share it with you all, which is that this is a study where they took 20 people. They divided them into three groups, and there's about 20 people in each group. So our M are people who are long-term relaxation response practitioners and do it daily. This N2 group were people that did not do it daily, but went through an 8-week training program and learned how to do it. And then this N1 group over here on the left are people that didn't do it and then they didn't get any training in it. And essentially what they wanted to see is, does it change gene expression? So this is a very fancy way of looking at how genes are upregulated and downregulated in our body. And what the takeaway is that you can see in general, right, that over here with our long-term meditators or relaxation response practitioners, there's a lot more red. In these folks that had just learned, there's also some more gene expression in red coming out. And then our N1s who didn't learn it and haven't practiced it, they have a lot more green. So we can, and a lot of these ones that were being expressed were ones that are things that are created and are relevant to cellular metabolism, oxidation, and other things that influence essentially cellular damage and inflammation. So we are seeing, like, on a genetic level, that there is a response to relaxing. And so their conclusion was daily relaxation response practice may counteract cellular damage related to chronic physiological stress. Of course, the question with this and all things is, just because we're seeing a change in gene expression, does that change our health outcomes? And that is something that's going to take a long time to figure out, but it is a really cool study. All right, and just kind of like another sort of piece of the evidence. This is a crazy looking thing. It's called an evidence map. So it looked at all kinds of conditions and asked how many studies have looked at mindfulness and how it can affect it. What kinds of mindfulness have been studied, and how good is the effect, or how good is the evidence that it is helpful? And this actually comes out of the VA, and the VA has really impressively, like, been at the forefront of thinking about how all of these things and the lifestyle things can affect health and make it better. So they've really done a lot, and it's pretty great to see. But as you can see, a lot of stuff is in this unclear evidence graph, but we do have several things and the potential positive effect. And kind of like we've talked about, there's anxiety, there's cancer, depression, there's mental illness, depression, chronic illness, and kind of like overall health. So there's reasonable evidence that these can be helpful. So, all right, thinking about mind-body practices. I put them into two categories. I kind of thought about, there's some that are like not moving and more about kind of both about attention focusing, but more specifically about attention focused. So classic example is sitting meditation. You can also do guided imagery. Self-hypnosis is a different kind. A specific kind of mindfulness called mindfulness-based stress reduction, you'll often see it abbreviated MBSR, has been studied extensively, and there's pretty good evidence for it for many things. And it's because it's pretty regimented, so it's easy to replicate for studies. This is like it's kind of a classic 8-week class. You meet for 2 to 3 hours once a week. There is a homework involved, and then there's one Saturday class. It was pioneered by a gentleman you may have heard of named Jon Kabat-Zinn, who wrote a book called Full Catastrophe Living. Beautiful turn of phrase. Who kind of really wanted to bring, he was a Zen Buddhist practitioner and wanted to bring the benefits that he felt, but kind of wanted to make it accessible to everyone, not just people that were really interested in Zen Buddhism. There's something called centering prayer. So specifically, if you are of the Christian faith, this is a kind of meditation that is specifically applicable for you. There's lots of apps that can kind of work you through starting how to meditate. Some of the ones I like are Insight Timer, Smiling Mind, Headspace, Calm. Waking Up is Sam Harris's app, and he really loves evidence. So if you're really geeky and like love understanding why you're doing something, he's really good at that. A lot of these, you can, like most apps, you can get some stuff for free. And then if you have to pay to join to get everything. There's also something called the Heart Math Institute, and they sell products for heart rate variability. So you can kind of put it on your finger, you can put on your ear, and you can actually watch your heart rate and see how what you're doing, what you're thinking, how you're breathing affects your heart rate. And then there's breath training. So just learning how to do different kinds of breathing practices. And I just want to say kind of basic things to think about meditation. Thoughts are okay. The whole point of meditation is not to have an empty mind. That is like advanced things that you don't have to worry about. Really the practice is just being present and acknowledging that thought and not responding to that thought, wishing that thought well and sending it on its way. So it's, the goal is not to have an empty mind. It's kind of learning how you respond to your thoughts, which is like the really beautiful part of it. And I would encourage people to like think about doing a class. Like everything else, it takes practice. And I really realized recently how like if you wanted to learn how to play tennis, you probably wouldn't just go to a tennis court and like start bouncing a ball around. Like you could, but if you really wanted to get good at it, you'd probably have to take a class and at least learn some basic techniques. I think meditation is the same way. And then there's like a second category that is not very scientific. I just made up that I call like moving meditation. There's shaking meditations you can look up. I would say that both Qigong and Tai Chi are moving meditations. You could probably argue that a lot of forms of yoga are moving meditations. Yoga has many manifestations. And Angela likes that one. Yoga has many manifestations in our culture. Some of them are like very purely physical and probably do not have much of a mindfulness or meditation aspect, and some really do. So it certainly is possible that that could be part of it. And really, I kind of think about anything that requires moment-to-moment focus. It is a form of moving meditation. So that could be like dancing. It could be cooking. Recently, I went and learned how to like fly an actual physical like, big kite with someone. And like, I could keep it up in the air, but I had to be like in that moment all the time, making like responding to every move of the air changes. And I was like, this is just like meditation. Amazing. I mean, sometimes exercise can do that for us, like even doing puzzles. Like there's lots of ways that if you think about it, you are doing these things kind of mindfully. Also, this is definitely technically not a moving meditation, but I just wanted to kind of throw out EMDR and somatic therapy. So eye movement desensitization and reprocessing and somatic therapy are both two of the things that we think about for trauma, and which a lot of us have gone through various forms of, we called it big T trauma and tiny T trauma. I think that has been alluded to in other presentations. And both of them focus on movement as a way to kind of like, you really feel like our body holds that trauma, and movement is a way to kind of release it. All right. I was going to do a 4-7-8 breathing practice, but I think in the interest of time, I will just hold off on that for now. And if we want to come back to it, we can. If you want to look it up, you can Google it. It's very easy and straightforward to do. I like it a lot. Okay, let's talk about our last thing, which is sleep. Sleep, also very hip right now. The CDC, this is from 2016. Did you get enough sleep last night? A third of adults aren't getting enough sleep. The American Psychological Association says that more sleep would make most people in the US happier, healthier, and safer. And then I love this chart. I'd never seen it from the CDC in 2014. They're looking at people who get less than 7 hours of sleep for adults, so age 18 and older. And essentially the darker the color, the more people are that are getting less than 7 hours. And it is really interesting to see that it's a coastal phenomenon, and it's actually much more prevalent on the East Coast. And these people in the Great Plains states, they know what's up. They're getting enough sleep, or relatively. There's still maybe a quarter of them that aren't getting enough sleep, but they got the message. And again, not a great deal of evidence specifically about autoimmune things, but we certainly know that it's important. We know that it's linked to the development and also the course and how well control of things like diabetes, cardiovascular disease, obesity, and depression. So this is one kind of interesting article I found specifically about alopecia areata and sleep. This was a retrospective study. So they went back essentially and looked at medical records of patients in Korea. And they looked at about 25,000 patients with sleep disorders. And then they also looked at 129,000 control subjects, so people who didn't have sleep disorders, and then looked at what was the likelihood of someone who had a sleep disorder developing alopecia or another autoimmune disease. And their conclusion was that sleep disorders are independent risk factors for alopecia areata, especially in individuals under the age of 45. And that they're also associated with comorbid diseases, including solid organ cancers, autoimmune thyroiditis, vitiligo, and rheumatoid arthritis. Sleep is important for us. Right, tips for better sleep. So we want to be consistent, going to bed at the same time every day, trying to get up at the same time every day, try not to have more than an hour difference even on the weekends. Make sure your bedroom is quiet, dark, relaxing, it's at a cool temperature. You've probably heard the phrase, the bedroom is for sleep and sex and not much else. no electronics. So get your TVs, your computers, your smartphones, try and have it out of your bedroom. Obviously working at home, this has been tricky. Both of those have maybe been a little bit trickier for some people. Avoid large meals, caffeine and alcohol before bedtime, especially alcohol. If you have any trouble going to sleep, try cutting out the alcohol for a couple of weeks. It really messes with our natural sleep rhythm. Being physically active every day, we know that can help. And then really, if you are having sleep issues, and it's, we're all gonna like not sleep well, a couple nights a month, whatever is bothering us can keep us up. But if it's a consistent issue, do see your primary care doctor, because you could have a sleep disorder that needs to be diagnosed and could be treated, the most common of which is sleep apnea, which really can affect a lot of quality of life and health issues. So I just wanted to highlight, there's a, I call him the Ben Brown rules. He's an integrative medicine doctor that kind of created this. 10 hours before bed, no caffeine. 3 hours before bed, no food or exercise. 2 hours before, you dim your screens. Maybe you put on your blue light blocking glasses. You try and stop working. 1 hour before, limit light exposure even more and try and stop screens altogether. And he also really is an advocate of no snooze alarm. So he really feels like hitting the snooze button doesn't help us get into good sleep rhythm. So he's like, if you need to sleep some more, but don't hit the snooze alarm. Okay, couple more sleep ideas that I always talk about with my patients. Guided imagery can be useful, specifically guided imagery called progressive muscle relaxation. So getting every muscle in your body to relax. I have had patients have success with that. Interestingly, I've heard several meditation teachers say, don't meditate right before bed. It can actually be kind of like activating and stimulating. So guided imagery is one thing, but just doing pure meditation can actually potentially have the counter effect. Free journaling. So actually just journaling about your day, journaling about whatever is on your mind, what concerns you have. There's actually reasonable evidence that just doing that before bedtime can help with sleep. You could also think about self-massage of your neck, your arms, your legs, and your feet, just kind of like, it's kind of like almost like telling your body it's time to relax, giving yourself a little self-love. There's really nice YouTube videos that can just do like self-massage before bedtime. Lots of ideas out there. Aromatherapy is always nice. Obviously the classic smell is lavender. You can get that in lotions. You can put it in a diffuser. There's actually like little sort of like containers that you can just put essential oil in and just smell them directly. And then if you really have chronic insomnia, you've seen your doctor, ruled out medical things, there is something called a chronic, cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia. And it has really pretty fabulous evidence. And I've sent patients to it and to our practitioner at UCSF. And I've had, both of them have been like, that was life-changing. So really positive feedback for that. And also we have evidence that it can help. It's about a once a week kind of course. If you really can't sleep, get out of the bed and do a calm activity is what we always tell folks. It's really hard to do, but if you're lying in bed for hours, get up, get out of bed so your body doesn't learn to associate the bed with sleep. Have dim lights and do something that's relatively calming. Don't look at your phone and start reading the news. All right, so I feel like I've thrown a lot of things at you, but hopefully it's been helpful. Hopefully it makes sense. I had to include my favorite comic about going on a plant-based diet. So eat plants, try and be active most days of the week for at least 30 minutes, figure out some kind of mindfulness self-care routine, and get enough sleep. And I will pause there.
So thank you so much for all of this useful information. That was totally awesome, seriously. Angela, what are your thoughts right now?
I definitely found some points in your presentation of things that I need to work on. I think some people think, oh, you know, she's a doctor. She knows all this stuff. And so she like lives all of it. And that's, not the case. This is like very challenging for, physicians too. And so I'm definitely looking forward to kind of incorporating some of these things. I asked a question in the chat to see if anyone had experience with the blue light blocking glasses. I wear contacts, but yeah, I was interested in maybe checking those out the days that I wear my glasses, or getting one for my sister too, if anyone has any personal experience. There are three questions that I ran across in the chat, and I wanted to get started asking some questions. And then if anyone has any further questions, please type in the chat. And if you want to ask a question live to Dr. Rowe, you can just raise your hand on Zoom, and then I'll allow you to unmute yourself and show yourself, and you can ask some questions. But I'll get started with the questions that were in the chat. So someone was asking
Before we get started, Dr. Rowe, did you mention, I know that you said before that you also had like a chronic dermatologic condition too. Did you get to talk about that story at all?
No, thanks for reminding me, Renee. And also, I realized that I never talked about how I got interested in integrative medicine. So I can also bring that in. Yeah. I also just wanted to echo what Angela said. It's a struggle for all of us, and the struggle is real. I remember when I was in my lecture about that physical activity, and you see that graph and you know you're not doing that, you're just like, oh my goodness. So it's part of the process, having grace with yourself, recognizing we live in a culture that essentially creates the opposite environment to this. So like doing little baby steps every day. I started making myself like mini goals. Like in April, I was like, you're getting to bed on time. I don't care about anything else. You're getting 8 hours. So it's a constant process. Obviously very, a different experience than what you have all have had with the alopecia areata, but I essentially was born with, I would call a significant dermatological issue when I was born. So I spent, I had 10 major surgeries before the age of 12. I spent a lot of my young life in and out of doctor's offices and hospitals. So I certainly have an appreciation for what you all have gone through, different experience, but, also, you know, lots of touchstone points, good and bad, mainly good actually with the medical community as a young kid. For years, I hated the smell of hospital hallways, or stairwells, and like would not go in them. And if I had to, I would hold my breath and like run up the stairwells. Like I just hated that smell. So how I got interested in integrative medicine, it's straightforward and not straightforward answer, which is that I think I just naturally grew up like a little kid that was interested in sort of like nature, and that sort of stuff just really appealed to me. I wanted to be a vegetarian when I was like 14, or I think 12. I didn't become a vegetarian until I was 14, but I wanted to when I was 12. So I think for whatever reason, that is sort of like these like more natural things have always been interesting to me. And then when I decided to become a doctor, decided I wanted to be an MD, because access was really important to me, and I wanted to get to serve lots of different kinds of people who had lots of different experiences at the time. And still a lot of these things are, for better or for worse, like limited to people that can afford them, because healthcare, then the way our insurance system is set up, won't always pay for it. You know, it's still hard to get my patients with pre-diabetes to get to a nutritionist and get insurance to cover it, which is just maddening. It's like, okay, so you want to wait for them to develop the disease until they eat right? Like, what is the logic behind this? I also kind of along the way had good experiences. In college, I saw a speaker. Her name is Dr. Ifeoma Akinze. She has a practice in Marin, and she is a medical doctor, but also trained in naturopathy. I randomly went to her lecture, and the way she talked about health and healing, like totally blew my mind and just really opened up the possibility that I could be a doctor. I also worked on a family run farm. We talked about like fresh fruits and vegetables all the time. So I went into medical school knowing that I was interested in all of this, and then learned about the field of integrative medicine, got to do a rotation in it in my fourth year of medical school, and was like, oh, I'm definitely doing this. Like, I love primary care, but this is also really important to me, enough so that like I want to do a fellowship in it. That's my sort of long-winded, circuitous answer.
Well, thank you for letting us know that. You want to go ahead and get started with the questions, Angela? Did you get the question about Angela's, I guess, question about blue light?
Yeah. Angela, I guess your question was just like people's experiences with them.
Yeah, I was just interested if it's something like worth investing. I would need to get, me and my sister would need to get prescription blue light glasses. And so I'm like, is it something worth it? Or like kind of what, I was just interested in if you had any patients who had experiences or anyone like in the chat, if they wanted to talk about their experiences.
Yeah, yeah. I'd be curious to see people's experiences in the chat. I think like the actual evidence for the blue light blockers is not that great. It kind of makes sense. And you know, now it's like I think just like the over-the-counter ones are pretty inexpensive. So I have patients that use them. It's one of those things where you're like, yeah, can't really hurt except for the price. So like, go ahead and try it. Probably, you know, now a lot of our phones have the evening time thing that supposedly makes less blue light. So I also encourage people to do that. But you can experiment with it, but I feel like probably just like avoiding the screen is the way to go if you can.
So trying to scoot around the actual issue. We'll jump into the questions now. So the first question that I saw was about apple cider vinegar. And I'll read the question from the chat. So is apple cider vinegar with the mother effective in reducing autoimmune related inflammation? I didn't know what the mother was. And so I typed in the chat, what is the mother? And apparently it's the cloudy film in the apple cider vinegar that settles at the bottom of the bottle and swirls around with the bottle when the bottle is shaken. So I learned something new today, but do you have any kind of insight on that?
Yeah. The mother also is the SCOBY. So when you make kombucha, it's the SCOBY, which is the, oh my gosh, symbiotic community of bacteria and yeast. So it's like this like funny little like rubbery thing that will like grow on the top of your kombucha. And it's called the mother because it makes like babies, which you can use to like make more kombuchas. So I do not know of evidence specifically about the mother and apple cider vinegar and autoimmune disease. My suspicion, though I cannot, I would have to double check this, is probably that's considered fermented if there's the mother in it. So it's probably at the very least helping with your microbiome, which could thereby potentially be helping with autoimmune diseases. Again, it's still kind of in the beginning nascent stages of understanding that. But probably a good thing to do.
Okay. Do you know if there's any difference between like the liquid ACV versus like the pill form of ACV?
I don't. In general, I honestly don't know how much this applies to the apple cider vinegar in particular. Mm-hmm. In general, I really try and encourage people to get things from the source and not from a pill form if they can. We see that with the probiotics. We also see that another classic thing is like with the omega-3s, people love taking omega-3 pills. And like, that's okay. And like, sometimes there's some evidence for it. I think there actually is some evidence for it in rheumatoid arthritis. But in a lot of things, when you look at the general trends and studies, if people are eating a lot of fish that are high in omega-3s, there's a clear correlation with decreased mortality, improved cardiovascular health, and a lot of times other things in terms of like chronic illnesses and joint issues. But like with people taking omega-3s as a pill, it's much harder to tease out that data and figure out if it's actually causing anything. And there's like lots of reasons for that. Like people argue a lot about like the study qualities and what they did or didn't do. My pet theory is that probably there's other things in the fish that are helping. Is it helping our body absorb the omega-3? Is it helping our body use the omega-3 appropriately, like some sort of like a cofactor in a reaction? So I, same thing. Like, I'm like, just eat the fish, just get enough fish in every week. I think that's much better than taking the pill.
I see a question in the chat. Who is the person who wrote about the tendency?
Oh, yes. Her name is Gretchen Rubin. Gretchen is G-R-E-T-C-H-E-N, and Rubin is R-U-B-I-N. And if you just Google Gretchen Rubin for tendencies, obviously, you do like this eight question quiz. Of course, she wants her email address, and then she like will send you her like little newsletter. But I don't know, her newsletter is fun. You can unsubscribe, and she does. I do think it's really fun to kind of like see what you are, and then she has some good suggestions on like, here are the things that are going to motivate you. And obviously, it's like not perfect, but you know, when I did mine and read it, I was like, well, it's kind of true.
I think I see the next question. Have you seen any alopecia patients have positive results, hair growth, from any of the suggestions that you made today?
No, I have not. And I have to say, like, because I'm not a dermatologist, I do not see a lot of patients with alopecia. I see patients with alopecia, but it's mainly due just to hormonal changes over time. It's not specifically alopecia areata, like another autoimmune condition. And that's kind of where I go back to a lot of what we're talking about is like creating sort of like your good soil, like your good starting things. And like, I don't think anything I'm talking about, I mean, maybe, but like probably unlikely that it's going to reverse the course of alopecia, but like, could it create like a, and could it help with progression? Could it help with sort of like, certainly like general stressors, which might be related. I think potentially yes. So I guess I just want to emphasize that nothing I'm saying, I don't think like independently is going to cure this issue, but I do think it could like help with any number of sort of like contributing factors.
We had a dermatologist that was on for like our last episode, and we talked a lot about autoimmunity, inflammation, and really kind of how our gut microbiome is kind of related to alopecia. So I believe that there's like more studies that is coming out that if we kind of control that anti-inflammatory process, maybe it may do something with the course of alopecia. Who knows? I guess we'll just kind of have more studies to see what's going to happen with that.
Yeah.
Any thoughts on that?
I just had a follow-up question. So I know you don't specifically see a lot of alopecia areata patients and follow them, but it sounds like you do see a lot of individuals just in general with autoimmune and rheumatologic conditions. And I'm wondering if you've seen any improvement in any of those conditions as you've been following patients during your fellowship.
And I think like the answer is basically like, yes, but it's like really hard to quantify or qualify, honestly, because patients are so different and they have so many things going on. My colleague, who's a rheumatologist, actually, and she's at the Osher Center, so the Integrative Medicine Center, she sees most of her patients. She sees a lot of our rheumatological patients, so like the lupus, the rheumatoid arthritis. And these are, I kind of double checked with her before I talked to be like, these are the things I'm going to talk about. This makes sense to you, right? And she's like, oh yeah, that is exactly what I talk to each of my patients about. So all that to say, like, I think response is so variable because of course, like my patients with multiple sclerosis are also on multiple sclerosis medications. My patients with autoimmune thyroiditis are also on those medications. So it's hard to be like, this did this thing. But I definitely think it improves their quality of life. It can help with symptoms. I was going to say, I see a lot of fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue patients, which is, gosh, just hard to manage. And I have had one or two patients where I like literally just told them about the anti-inflammatory diet. They went home and started eating more vegetables and they're like, my joints don't hurt anymore. Which seems sort of, in a way, hard to believe, but also it's like, great, it worked, fabulous, carry on.
That is wonderful. I think in general, I'm sure everyone on the call can agree, autoimmune conditions are hard to treat. A lot of these conditions don't have a cure. They have stressors that some of us can't even identify what the stressors are or the triggers. A lot of people have different stories of how they came to develop it and the progression. And I think it's really challenging. And so I'm just thankful that there's any kind of evidence or any stories, even if they're anecdotal, about patients who are improving with any of these suggestions. So I think that's pretty incredible. I was going to ask the next question that I see here. So there's an individual who has a full set of autoimmune conditions. So they have psoriasis or psoriatic arthritis, lupus, alopecia, and hypothyroidism. Mm. And they're wondering, what is the number one suggestion that you could give for health and healing for their autoimmune conditions?
Yeah. Wow. That you are dealing with a lot. Of course I think of number one and then like three things come to mind. So it's really hard to choose a number one. My kind of like rational mind is like diet. I just think diet and nutrition is so important because it's something we do three times a day. And it really is the basis. It's the basis of health. So making sure that you're eating a plant-based diet is going to be essential to improving your quality of life and kind of having, again, like having that foundation of care and like creating a healthy soil. So even while you're dealing with these other things, you're creating a good foundation for yourself. And that being said, I think the other thing that sort of just came to mind is that having that many chronic conditions must just be incredibly like difficult and stressful. And I kind of like highlighting, I think what Angela and Renee talked about in one of their seminars is like making sure you have good support, whether that is like social support, also therapy support, doing what you can to take care of yourself. Like that is really making sure that your mental health is being addressed while you're going through all of these medical things, which can be really, really tough, is really important. And I would just say like, it's just stressful. Being in the medical environment is stressful. I went to the doctor as a patient and it almost made me cry. And I was like, why is this making me cry? And it's because like, you're so vulnerable in such a funny way. It's tough. So making sure you're taking care of your mental health, I think it's really important.
Thank you. I think our next question was from Diana. Question here, I'm just gonna read it. Any advice for those with alopecia areata who see flares with vaccines and possibly viral colds ever since their 30s, was finally getting my hair growing in and not having new spots after a flare after my first flu in a decade in March of 2020. And now getting a new bald spot 3 weeks after my COVID vaccine. My doctor said since both flare and your immune system, vaccines will worth it, especially because I work in a vet field where social distancing is not possible. I'm not trying to say vaccines are bad, but wondering if I need to reevaluate if I should vaccinate again, because my first flare was after tetanus, flu, and a series of rabies vaccines about a year apart in my 30s.
I'm not sure I have anything super insightful to add to that. I can see why you're pausing and questioning. I would definitely agree with your doctor that like vaccines are worth it and like essential. So I would not discourage you from getting the vaccines. It might be interesting if you can afford it, if it's something that makes sense to you, to go talk to a functional medicine doctor. It's just what came to mind. Functional medicine doctors really think a lot about kind of like the like biochemical immunological processes that are going on. They think a lot about our immune system. They might have some ideas for you. It's interesting. I wonder if it's like when we get an infection or we get a vaccine, essentially it's activating our immune system, which maybe is activating, obviously, the part of your immune system that's causing the alopecia. I don't have a really elegant solution for that. I'm sorry, but it might be interesting to talk to someone who knows more about it than I do. And again, not to be like, should I not get this vaccine, but more just like, do you have any other suggestions of things I can do so it doesn't activate all of my immune system?
Thank you for answering that. I think vaccines are a really tough topic because I have heard quite a few people say, hey, they're developed alopecia specifically or an autoimmune condition after I got a vaccine, or it worsened after I got a vaccine. And I think it's tough as a physician myself with alopecia to, you know, promote vaccines when there's so many of these stories out there. And I think it can be really challenging, especially now with COVID, and, you know, vaccines, the question of vaccines and safety, and its relation to autoimmune conditions coming up. I will say that NAF, the National Alopecia Areata Foundation, that sponsors this webinar episode, did put out a bulletin notification about COVID and vaccines. And so I'd like everyone to take a look at that, just to kind of read for yourself what the stance is of this, you know, national foundation dealing with alopecia is regarding COVID and the vaccine. There was, speaking of COVID, there was a question about COVID, and then there also was a question about magnesium. I'm going to ask in a moment, but first I'll ask the COVID question because we're on that topic. But in regards to COVID, so someone asked in the chat if those with alopecia areata have a worse effect from COVID compared to others without alopecia. And I just wrote back the answer that I haven't seen any evidence stating that. But in general, about autoimmune conditions, I feel comfortable asking you this. Have you seen any evidence about those with autoimmune conditions having a worse effect if they develop COVID versus those who do not have autoimmune conditions?
I have not, which doesn't mean that data is not out there. It's just not something that I have come across yet. Have either of you?
No, I feel like a lot of what I've seen, and it's kind of hard to say. So at first I read a lot about those with kind of chronic medical conditions having a worsening kind of response to COVID. Mm-hmm. So I think the easiest one for me to think of is like, if you're a smoker and you have COPD, which is a chronic lung condition from smoking, if you get COVID, which is a lung specific kind of viral illness, then you can have a COPD flare and it worsens and kind of turns into pneumonia and things can kind of get worse from there. But for autoimmune conditions specifically, as someone who does full-time emergency medicine, I have not seen kind of a connection there. Have you, Renee?
I have not.
Yeah. And you'd think that, I'm sure as we're studying and learning about COVID, we're watching what conditions are making it worse. And I'm sure that they are monitoring that with autoimmune. So, I mean, this is extrapolation, but you'd think if there was a correlation, we would know about it and it would have been on the list of conditions. I think group two, the people with conditions where they have autoimmune would have been on that list. And I don't think it was,
yeah. But then there's still more. I'm sure like 3 months from now, we'll have more data about a lot of different things. And then 6 months from now, we'll have even more data. And then it's really going to depend on who's studying it too at the same time. I can't directly say that there's any evidence that we're seeing like the data right now.
The next question that I saw in the chat was about magnesium. I'm going to open up the chat just so I can read it word for word. So can you say if magnesium is helpful in hair loss? Any kind of insight for that?
You know, it's not directly that I'm aware of. I don't think it's something that has been studied, however. I will say, and I sort of like did not discuss supplements, just because I think it's complicated to talk about supplements to a general audience, because Well, I think some of them can be beneficial. We obviously have to think about like supplement drug interactions. I also think like in certain conditions, there's certain people with medical conditions where I wouldn't want them on a particular supplement. Then there's the issue of making sure, because supplements are not regulated in the same way as our prescription medications, there are issues with adulteration. Do they contain what they say they contain? So it's something that I didn't like really focus on in our topic, but I actually do recommend magnesium not infrequently for my patients because there's like very few side effects. There's not really many drug interactions. Sometimes I use it for headaches, good for anxiety, sometimes helps with sleep. The main side effect is it can cause loose stools or diarrhea. And so for people that are constipated, it can help them. Maybe like very indirectly by helping sleep or anxiety, but there's no direct evidence as far as I know.
Nice, thank you for answering that. So I'm gonna ask if anyone else has any additional questions, please type them in the chat or the Q&A button or raise your hand on Zoom to ask a question live. But I had a question about skin. So even though my skin looks fabulous on Zoom, I think it's the lighting, I actually struggle a lot with acne. And I know it's not an autoimmune condition necessarily, but it is an inflammatory kind of condition, right? And so I'm wondering if kind of the tips that you gave today would help with kind of just skin, making skin better, clearer. And if you had any additional kind of recommendations aside from kind of actual medication.
Yes. Two things. So I'm actually meant to mention this. So I'm going to kind of answer this question with like my two hats on. I've also actually been studying Ayurvedic medicine this year with my program director who is trained in it. By studying, I'm using that term loosely. We meet once a month. He gives us some readings. Sometimes we'll meet and talk about patients from an Ayurvedic perspective. So I am by no means an expert and do not have the training as your speaker did from one of the other web series, but it is something that I think about a lot and like kind of tend to like frame issues in. And then also like, as you can tell from my perpetually shiny skin, I also have acne. And it's something that I've thought a lot about both personally and as a physician. So I will say yes. There's actually like pretty reasonable evidence that plant-based diets can help with acne. Some of the other great things you can do is actually limit dairy. Like we truly think there's probably a connection between dairy and acne outbreaks. Again, bringing in more plants. There's probably very minimal evidence for this, but I think it's fun, which is spearmint tea. So doing spearmint tea like twice a day might be helpful. And then actually, I know I just was trash talking probiotics, but there was at least one study that showed that taking probiotics can help with clear up some acne. And I think that study, you know, and sometimes I do encourage people sometimes to take probiotics, but it's more just like, this is a limited basis. You're doing it for a couple months to build up and help diversify your microbiome. And while you're doing it, you need to be eating fiber and changing your diet because they're just going to go straight through you if they don't have essentially good substrate to kind of do their magical biochemical reactions on. They're not really magical, but there you go. Of course, we also know, of course, that sleep affects skin quality and probably contributes to acne outbreaks. Stress definitely does. There's no question about that. So that's where like sort of like our mindfulness and meditation comes in. Not too sure about physical activity, though I actually think there might be some evidence that it can help. And kind of like framing it from like an Ayurvedic perspective, acne is related to pitta, which is also from Ayurveda, what they would say is causing alopecia or hair loss. And one of the things you can do for pitta is actually not drink as much coffee. Coffee is like very pitta aggravating. So I have sort of, and also due to like some back pain I was having that I was like, this is definitely pitta aggravation. I actually almost cut out coffee from my life and moved almost entirely to green tea, which also there's some evidence that green tea can help with skin issues. So that might be something else to try. So I do love cappuccinos. So I still get my cappuccinos on the weekend. But it might help.
Awesome. Thank you. I'm going to keep asking questions unless someone raises their hand. So I know you intentionally did not discuss supplements in your PowerPoint, just because there's just so much there. You can do like a presentation just solely on supplements. Mm-hmm. But I'm wondering, because this is kind of an autoimmune community, do you have like top three supplements that you believe are kind of low risk, that are safe to use, and that you feel like in general would be helpful for autoimmune anti-inflammatory patient or someone suffering from those conditions?
I mean, the classic one is turmeric or curcumin, which is the active ingredient in turmeric. And there is some reasonable evidence that it can help with osteoarthritis. There's reasonable evidence that it might help with rheumatoid arthritis. It's pretty safe. In like super high doses, there's like maybe it can cause some liver issues in some people. I actually saw an older patient, this was like back in residency, who was taking turmeric, was not eating a lot, and was pre-diabetic, basically meaning like his body was not regulating blood sugar as well, and had a hypoglycemic event in one of our stores in town where he passed out. And I one of my theories was, well, A, you need to like eat more for lunch, and B, I was wondering if the turmeric had actually like contributed to the hypoglycemia, because it can cause cause lower blood sugar. I shouldn't say hypoglycemia. So I guess I'm using hypoglycemia as like symptomatic low blood sugar, where you get like the shakes and you feel kind of nauseous and woozy. And it can interact with some medications. So turmeric would be a good one to take. I would still encourage you to talk to a doctor or someone that is able to kind of like do the interaction checker, kind of like look at like the side effects, make sure that it's safe for you. In all likelihood, it really probably is. And the dosing is like 500 grams, probably about 3 times a day is what I usually suggest, or 3 to 4 times a day. And one other note about supplements, kind of related to this in general, because they're not well regulated by the FDA. I mean, as I said, we have to worry about quality, purity. So you want to look for a seal of quality. In 2007, the FDA created the good manufacturing practices. So supplement companies have to abide by this good manufacturing practice, but it's basically honor code. Like, no one is going to make sure that they're doing this. But if companies want to, they can sign up for some independent nonprofits that will go in and confirm that they're following these guidelines. And those are three companies. One is it's USP, so United, I always get this wrong. It's like the United States Pharmacopoeia Organization. So it's like a little emblem that looks like USP. The other one is NSF, which I think is the National Science Foundation. They do lots of things, but one of them is checking supplement companies. And then a third one is a company called Consumer Lab, which is a little bit different. They're a nonprofit lab that checks these on their own and then actually publishes their data on their website, but you have to have access to it. So you have to like buy a membership, but things can also have the Consumer Lab seal on it. So you wanna do if you do get a supplement, make sure it has one of those seals on it, USP, NSF, or Consumer Lab. Okay, other ones to think about: omega-3s, but just get it in your diet. Boswellia can also be good for inflammation, but same issue. I don't know Boswellia as well off the top of my head. I'll suggest it for patients sometimes, but I always do double check, make sure it's not contraindicated with any of their other medical conditions, make sure it's not going to interact with anything. Ginger is also great for decreasing inflammation, but I generally just encourage people to get that in their diet and just put it in food, cut it up. Those are really the best ways to bring that in.
Now, I know you briefly mentioned you suggested one of the attendees to go to a functional medicine doctor. Mm-hmm. So could you briefly just tell us the difference between the integrative versus the functional medicine physician?
Yeah. Thanks, Renee. I was like, I should kind of explain that more. So I have a hard time discussing the difference because I think there is like a lot of overlap and you'll find a lot of integrative medicine doctors have done the functional medicine training course. It's IFM is mm-hmm. the organization. It's the Institute for Functional Medicine. So a lot of doctors go through the whole IFM training course. I say that I like dabble in functional medicine because I do some functional medicine things that I've just picked up over the last 2 years from my colleagues here. So you'll find a lot of overlap, but I definitely would suggest going to someone who has done the full functional medicine course so that they really have a true understanding of what that is. I would say most of them are either MDs or DOs, but functional medicine goes deeper into kind of the almost asking the whys of why this is going on. And they do a lot of things in terms of like, what was your childhood like? What were you doing up until this thing occurred? So kind of similar things to what we would think about in integrative medicine, and also really think about the lifestyle things we discussed. I will say that there's some controversy naturally in the biomedical field about functional medicine. A lot of them, you know, functional medicine doctors tend to order like a ton of tests that like we don't understand as MDs or DOs. They'll draw conclusions on these tests where, you know, biomedical doctors will be like, you can't draw that conclusion from that test. That's probably true too, to an extent. That being said, I have really gotten into a stool test that is straight functional medicine, and it's helped me treat a lot of patients. So it's also at the leading edge of all of this. And I have found it helpful. And it is with that question about the vaccines and having these flares, it just made me think like, I bet a functional medicine doctor would have something interesting to say about that.
I love it. Does anyone have any more questions or any other follow-up questions, Angela, that you may have right now?
There is a question that just popped up. So it's about pumpkin seed pills. There's someone who read about and researched pumpkin seed pills to help with inflammation. This individual's been taking it for a few months now, and they're just wanting to, it sounds like, make sure that you agree that pumpkin seed pills are good for inflammation.
Whoa, I honestly have no idea. I have not heard about that. As part of sort of like the plant-based diet, certainly I've heard about pumpkin seeds and, sometimes again, this might be anecdotal, but I tend to think about it in terms of like helping support the prostate. From sort of like that aspect of knowing that they have good omega-3s there, I could conceivably see that that might be a thing, but I honestly like know nothing about that. So again, I would encourage you to like, at a minimum, if you're taking those, most important is, look, make sure it has one of those seals on it. Again, USP, NSF, Consumer Lab. And then if you're really curious and motivated, you could go to PubMed, which is our medical kind of clearinghouse for every research article ever. And just like put in the search engine, pumpkin seeds and inflammation, and see what pops up.
Nice. I definitely have heard before this presentation, I heard pumpkin seeds were good for you. I think I just get a little worried about like what else could be in the pill form of it. And so that makes me a little concerned about actually buying a pill versus the natural version, which I feel like you've talked about a couple of times. Try the natural version as opposed to the actual pill.
Yeah.
I'm also wondering, kind of what leads someone to buy like a pill versus trying the kind of more natural form. Have you had that discussion in clinic at all, Aimee, about like why someone kind of buys a supplement versus like buying the natural form? Is it expenses? Is it time or ease or kind of what has come up in clinic for you?
You know, I haven't, it's an interesting question. And I haven't asked specifically patients that, like, usually I'll be like, oh, what were you hoping to achieve with this? What were you, you know, what made you decide to get it? But I haven't asked specifically like pill versus the actually getting it in the food. I do think, and please don't take this personally, I am certainly a victim of this as well. Or not a victim, but I have fallen for this as well. Or not even fallen. Sometimes I'll just do it out of whimsy. My co-fellow and I joke that we're doing Instagram medicine. And these folks are just like so good at advertising and convincing you that these things are valuable. You know, and now YouTube always has those ads that play. And like, because I do so much of this and I'm searching, doing search engines all day and like looking for this, that's definitely part of, they figured out that that is my algorithm. And I always get these ads about like, you know, take this pill, do these shots every morning. And all of them, I'm always like, I'm like, one is like turmeric and all of the medicinal mushrooms. And you're like, well, I mean, maybe that helps people, but like, do most people really need that? I don't know. So I do think a lot of us are influenced by like what we see on social media and on the internet. Mm-hmm. And like, they're so good at targeting ads to us now. And like, that's not always bad. Like you can get good resources out of that, but definitely, you know, sort of have like that critical eye on too. But also I don't know, I always really want to respect people too. And if it's something that is, you know, again, like Angela said, worrying about potential harms, but if it's something that you feel is helping you, talk to your doctor to make sure that it's safe. But like, if you feel like it helps you, that's great. That's carry mm-hmm. on.
Definitely. I was thinking about this, you said something earlier, I can't remember what it was, but it triggered this kind of question about meals and skipping meals. So I feel like as a healthcare provider, and I know some of us on the call are also kind of in healthcare, but there are a lot of professions where you kind of have to skip a meal or you don't quite get a lunch. And so you have to kind of eat when you can. And I know during my training, there were a lot of meals that were skipped and kind of eating less during the day because I didn't really have time. And then when I got home after my shift, I just kind of binge eat. And so I'm wondering if there's anything that is evidence-based about kind of meal size and like timing of the meals throughout the day. Can you talk a little bit about that in relation to like autoimmune condition or anti-inflammatory?
So I don't think I can talk about it in relation to immune or inflammation, because most of those studies and most of what I've learned is in terms of just control, obviously like metabolic syndrome and keeping people at like a healthy weight. And there, again, something that's kind of hard to study, I would say like more recently, you know, we always like loved talking about breakfast. Some people probably need breakfast. Some people probably don't. Probably what is important is not having dinner too late. That there's pretty clear evidence that eating late at night, you know, having like dinner 8, 9, and then going to bed an hour later, that probably does increase people's weight over time. And then, you know, probably it is pretty reasonable to have, you want to eat and then you want to have spaces and time where you're not eating. And again, like some people I think just are kind of like natural snackers. And if you are a healthy weight, that's fine for you. But probably for most of us, it's good to have like those pauses between meals.
Can you talk about why that's important?
You know, like the actual mechanism is sort of escaping me right now. I think it's something about how our hormones that are regulating our kind of like hunger hormones and how our body is using, how our body is like releasing insulin, how having those kind of like highs and lows kind of helps control that over time. I don't know, do either of you remember that from
it's like a relation to, it's like a relation to like ghrelin and cortisol and how that whole process and how it deals with like the hypothalamus and all of that. It's like a whole thing. because like it'll shut one system on, shut one system down. And then if you're over a certain system, your cortisol levels will increase, which will increase your inflammation, which is why your diet is very, very important, which is what you've kind of been talking about. Like, make our gut happy. That seems like that's the main thing at the end of the day, to be able to decrease the inflammation. So hopefully we will be able to control some of our autoimmune conditions that we have, you know, going on that's related to alopecia. Mm-hmm.
I don't know. It's good talk. Dr. Rowe, is there anything else that you think that you would like to add for our attendees or anything like that from today?
I just wanted to go back a minute to the pumpkin seed question. So I went to, I thought it would be fun. I should have thought of this before our talk. There's a great database that I think most medical institutions use called Natural Medicines. And it has a really nice comparative effectiveness chart. So I can go in and look at, like, think of a condition and then look to see, they kind of do like a summary of what things have been studied to treat it, like natural remedies have been studied to treat it, and what's the effectiveness. And the two things that came up that are probably effective for treating alopecia areata, one of them was in fact pumpkins. Let me see.
Are you able to share your screen?
I can. Yeah, let me do that again. Well, it's funny, it said alopecia areata, but now this is just the androgenic alopecia, but we can just share it again. We can take a look. Where's my share button? Okay, you can see the screen here. Let me go back. So this is what the chart looks like, the comparative effectiveness chart for alopecia. And you can see possibly effective, we have aromatherapy. Then pumpkin is for the hormonal form of alopecia. Possibly ineffective zinc. And then these are the many things where there's just not enough evidence to say. So adenosine, apple, a light therapy, which I think Dr. Natasha at least referenced. So lots of things we're not sure about. Sounds like the pumpkin is for more of the hormonal form, but just because it came up. It says taking pumpkin seed oil divided into two doses increases hair count by 30% compared with placebo. So sort of interesting. And then the aromatherapy, they kind of divide it by conditions. Here we go. There's some evidence that topically applying lavender oil, which I think also came up in that talk, in combination with essential oils of thyme, rosemary, and Atlantic cedar improves hair growth in up to 40% of patients after 7 months of treatment. The one thing I would say about the essential oils, which I do like, are that, and I think Dr. Natasha mentioned this as well, is that applying them directly without a carrier oil can cause issues for a lot of people who have sensitive skin. So it can cause rashes, can cause eczema, I've heard emergency room doctors talk about burns from essential oils. So I think that could be a fun and reasonable thing to try, but I would definitely make sure that you're using a carrier oil. So that means something else that the essential oil is inside. So like, I think fractionated coconut oil is a common one, probably just like using olive oil. In Ayurvedic medicine, sesame oil is a common carrier oil. So putting something else, not applying the essential oil directly to the skin.
Wow. Well, we're at the end of our time. I just want to thank you so much, Dr. Aimee, for coming on the webinar episode today and talking about just, it sounds like, optimizing your health in general, but as it relates to autoimmune and inflammatory conditions. It's been very helpful. And I do hope everyone will take a look back at the recorded episode, which should be posted on the NAF YouTube page and the NAF Let's Talk website probably in the next few days. So by the end of next week, it should be posted. I am getting some shout outs in the chat saying excellent presentation.
Thank y'all.
And we wish you luck as you complete your fellowship right this year. That's mm-hmm. wonderful.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for having me. Yeah, of course. Happy to be here. Glad you guys are doing this. And thanks for everyone for participating.
Yes. And then if I wanted to let everyone know, if you have any additional questions for Dr. Rowe, you can email NAF at info@naf.org. And then we can route them to Dr. Rowe. All right. Yes. So another webinar episode down, another great session, an educational session. And I hope everyone will go home and try some of these things that Dr. Rowe mentioned.
And also for you guys, our next webinar, I believe, will be on May 6th. I think that one we're talking about the clinical trials.
Yes, I'm just going to double check. So yes, we have an episode May 6th at 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time of an individual dermatologist from UC Davis who will be talking about clinical trials and how to get involved, what kind of the different aspects of clinical trials mean, and just really trying to educate our community about getting more involved with potential cures in the future for alopecia areata.
All righty. And we also invite you guys to register soon for the Lunapalacia, the National Alopecia Areata Foundation's annual conference. Everything will be online, but we'll be able to send you guys the registration link soon if it's not on the website already.
Yes. And Dr. Renee and I will be at the conference, the NAF conference, doing a session together. Dr. Renee is going to be doing a session separately as well. That should be really fantastic. So many other things. You can email us if you have any comments about the episode. So alopeciatalk@gmail.com. And then we're on Facebook. We have a Facebook group as well. If you have any interest in joining the Facebook group to find out about upcoming episodes.
All righty. We hope you guys have a good night.
Great. Have a good night. See you. Thanks for joining us.
Bye.
Bye.